the outdoor dry bulb air temperature. And you can also see here that the sole air temperature also depends upon the outdoor surface conductance H naught. Okay. So the advantage of defining a sole air temperature is that you can write the outdoor boundary condition also as H naught into T sole air minus T wall temperature. Okay. So the form looks simple, but the sole air temperature depends upon several factors like the radiation, solar geometry and outdoor convection and all that. Okay. The governing heat, now how do we solve? Now we have defined the governing equation as we have seen for a simple plane wall, okay, plane homogeneous wall, the governing equation is a partial differential equation. And you let us say that we have also specified the required initial and boundary conditions. So the problem is fully defined. Now the question is how do we solve it? You can solve this governing differential equation either by using an analytical method or by using numerical methods or by using empirical methods. So what are the typical characteristics of these methods? Analytical methods are used for simple geometries with simple boundary conditions. Okay, simple geometries means you have a plane wall. Okay, simple boundary conditions means outside temperature or outside radiation varies as a simple harmonic. Okay, for this kind of simple geometries and simple boundary conditions, you can derive an analytical expression or you can get an analytical solution. Okay. Whereas the numerical methods are very powerful and they can tackle complex geometries with any boundary condition. So this is the advantage of numerical methods. You can use the numerical methods for any type of any shape of the building or for any type of boundary conditions. Okay. However, numerical methods are in general more time consuming and the accuracy also they are not 100% accurate unlike analytical methods. And based on the form suggested by analytical methods, the heat transfer rate to the condition space at any time theta can be written as, so this as I said this is the form suggested by the analytical method. Okay, by the analytical method you can write at any time the heat transfer rate to the condition space, that is Q x is equal to 0 and theta, this is the heat transfer rate to the condition space as I have said. That is equal to UA, where U is the overall heat transfer coefficient of the wall, A is the surface area of the wall, multiplied by T sole air subscript m minus Ti plus UA into lambda into T sole air theta minus phi minus T sole air subscript m. So what are all these things? This one T sole air subscript m is what is known as mean sole air temperature. Let us say that you find the mean sole air temperature for the 24 hours. You calculate the hourly sole air temperature and find an average of that. So that is the mean sole air temperature, T sole air subscript m. Okay. Then Ti is the temperature of the conditioned space which we are assuming to be constant, right? And this lambda, okay, is what is known as decrement factor, right? I'll explain what it is. And then this phi is what is known as, phi is what is known as time lag factor. Okay. And here T sole air, look at this temperature, what is this? I am calculating heat transfer rate at some time theta. Okay. So this is written as in terms of temperature at time theta minus phi, okay, where phi is the time lag. That means let us say that I am calculating heat transfer rate at 6 pm okay, on a particular wall. I want to know what is the heat transfer rate from the wall to the conditioned space at 6 pm and let the wall has a time lag of 5 hours. Okay. Then T sole air subscript theta minus phi is the temperature of the wall or the sole air temperature of the wall at 6 minus 5, that is 1 pm. Okay. So that is the meaning of theta minus phi. Okay. And now coming to decrement factor, what is the decrement factor? Due to the large but finite thermal capacity of the wall, the heat transfer to the conditioned space is less than the heat transfer to the outer surface of the wall. Okay. As I have already explained to you, because of the thermal capacity of the wall, Q in is not equal to Q out, and it may so happen that Q in is much larger than the Q out. So this introduces a factor called as decrement factor. Okay. Similarly, you have what is known as the time lag factor. And what is the time lag factor? The time lag is the difference between the time at which the outer surface receives heat and the time at which the inner surface senses it. So let me give an example. Let us say that you have a wall here. Okay, let us say that this is a wall and this is the outdoor and this is the indoor. Let us say that suddenly this wall experiences some heat transfer. Okay, let us say that at this time, let us say time is 4 p.m. Okay, at 4 p.m. this wall, so outer surface of the wall is suddenly exposed to some heat transfer Q in. Okay, and because of the thermal capacity of the wall, you find that the inner surface does not sense this immediately. Okay, some time is required for the inner surface to sense this heat transfer, and let us say that if the time lag is 3 hours, okay, then you will find that this inner surface senses this heat transfer at 4 plus 3, that is 7 p.m. Okay, so this is what is known as time lag. This is the reason why if the outside temperature is maximum, say at 3 p.m., we find that the indoor temperature in an unconditioned room is maximum at say 7 p.m. or 8 p.m. Okay, for example, at mid noon, at 12 o'clock, outside may be the hottest, but inside the room, temperature will be very high, not at 12 o'clock, but maybe at 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock. Okay, so this is because of the thermal capacity of the wall. Okay, and this factor is known as time lag factor, right? And the decrement and time lag factors depend on the thermal capacity of the wall. Obviously, what is the thermal capacity of the wall? The thermal capacity of the wall depends upon the density of the wall, thickness of the wall, and specific heat of the wall. Thicker walls with large thermal capacity have small decrement factor and large time lag, and vice versa. Okay, so let me show that variation of decrement and time lag factor. This graph here shows the decrement factor as a function of wall thickness. Okay, these are calculated for building material having a specific heat of 840 joule per kg Kelvin. Okay, so you can see that the decrement factor is 1 when the thickness is 0. Okay, that means there is no wall and the decrement factor is 1, and as the wall thickness increases, the decrement factor reduces. Okay, so in general, the decrement factor varies between 0 to 1. Okay, thicker walls have lower decrement factors, thinner walls have higher decrement factors. Okay, next, this graph shows the variation of time lag with wall thickness and for different types of walls having different densities. Okay, so you can see that as the wall thickness increases, the time lag increases. Okay, for example, for 450 mm thick wall, the time lag could be 15 hours. Okay, similarly for 150 mm wall, the time lag is 5 hours, like that. Okay, as heat transfer to the conditioned space depends on time decrement and time lag, it varies with thermal capacity of the wall. Okay, so obviously the heat transfer rate, as we have seen, depends upon the solar temperature, which in turn depends upon the decrement and time lag factor, and decrement and time lag factor depend upon the thermal capacity of the wall. So finally, you find that the heat transfer to the conditioned space depends among other factors on the thermal capacity of the wall. Okay, so let me show a typical variation of heat transfer rate. Okay, this graph here shows the heat transferred to the conditioned space, okay, not heat flux, but heat total heat transfer to the conditioned space as a function of solar time, okay, for a thin wall, a thick wall, okay, and a thicker wall. So you can see that the heat transfer rate increases from about 8 a.m. that means slightly 1 or 2 hours after the sunrise. For a thin wall, the heat transfer rate increases in this manner, and it reaches a peak at about 4 p.m. and then again it starts decreasing. Okay, and it reaches a minimum at about 8 a.m. Okay, and for a thick wall, again it starts increasing from about 8 a.m. It reaches a peak, you can see that around at midnight, okay, not during the daytime but during the night time, and again it decreases. And for a still thicker wall, you find that the peak heat transfer rate takes place not at not during the daytime at all, but it takes place at about 4 a.m. that means in the morning. Okay, so this is the effect of the thickness of the wall on the heat transfer to the conditioned space at different times. And you can also see that the total heat transfer rate, that is nothing but the area under this curve, is much higher for the thin wall compared to the thick wall. Okay, so one thing is that the peak heat transfer rate for the thin wall is very high, and the total heat transfer rate for the thin wall is also high compared to the thick walls. So, since the peak heat transfer rate and the total heat transfer to the conditioned space are smaller for thick walled buildings, the required cooling capacity of the system will be less for thick walled buildings. So, it is an advantage, and energy required for the air conditioning system is also less for thick walled buildings. Okay. So, this is also an advantage, and you will find that if the wall is sufficiently thick, then it is possible to maintain reasonably comfortable temperatures inside buildings even without any artificial air conditioning systems, okay, because of the small decrement factor and large time lag. In fact, this is the principle behind the old temples and old forts or old buildings which have very thick walls. Okay, you find that these buildings even without any air conditioning are very comfortable even during peak summer. Okay, so this is because of the large thermal capacity of the building, which introduces small decrement factor and a large time lag. Okay. And now let us look at empirical methods for cooling load estimation. Heat transfer rate to the conditioned space can be written as we have seen by this expression. Okay, and this is written in terms of UA into some delta T effective, where this delta T effective is called as equivalent temperature difference ETD or cooling load temperature difference CLTD. And from this expression you can easily find that the equivalent temperature difference or cooling load temperature difference is given by this expression. So, it includes the solar mean solar temperature, the time lag and the decrement, and it also includes the inside temperature. Okay, so all these factors are included. So you can find that the ETD or CLTD depends on decrement and time lag factors, solar radiation and ambient temperature through solar temperature, and inside temperature TI. Okay, and tables of ETD and CLTD have been prepared for fixed values of inside and outside temperatures. For example, they are available in ASHRAE handbooks for different latitudes, orientations and different types of walls and roofs. Okay, so let me show typical tables. Okay, so this is the CLTD table for a flat roof without suspended ceilings, and this is taken from ASHRAE handbooks, and here you have 4 different types of roofs. 3, 4, 5, 6, and the description of the roofs are given here. Type 3 is 100 mm thick lightweight concrete, type 4 is 150 mm thick lightweight concrete, type 5 is 100 mm thick heavyweight concrete, type 6 is roof terrace system, and the properties are given here: mass per unit area, okay, and the heat capacity, and the CLTD values are given as function of solar time. You can see that for this wall, for example, type 3 wall at 7 solar time minus 2 is the CLTD value, at 8 AM this is 1 degree, at 9 AM this is 5 degrees, and this is at 10 AM 11 degrees, like that. Okay. Similarly, for different types of roofs at different solar times, and this table gives the CLTD values for vertical D type wall. Okay, and the description of the D type wall is given. D type wall means 100 mm face brick with 200 mm concrete block and interior finish, or 100 mm face brick and 100 mm concrete block with interior finish. Since it is a vertical wall, the orientation comes into picture, whether it is north facing or northeast facing, right? This is north facing, northeast facing, east facing, southeast facing, like that. Okay, and at different solar times, right? So these are the temperatures in Kelvin, and you can also see here the maximum CLTD value. For example, for east facing wall, 18 degrees Kelvin is the maximum CLTD. And for southeast wall also it is 18 degrees, and for the west facing wall it is 23 degrees, like that. Okay. So, this kind of tables are available in ASHRAE handbooks. Now, what is the validity of ASHRAE handbooks? The ASHRAE handbooks have ASHRAE tables have been obtained for inside temperature of 25 degrees centigrade and maximum outside temperature of 35 degrees centigrade with an average value of 29 degrees centigrade and a daily range of 12 degrees centigrade. What is daily range? Daily range means maximum outdoor temperature minus minimum outdoor temperature. Okay. So that value is taken as 12 degrees centigrade. Now, for inside and average outside temperatures other than the above, the following adjustment has to be made to CLTD values obtained from ASHRAE tables. Okay, so if your values are different, for example, the inside temperature, okay, is not 25 degrees but something else. Okay, similarly, the outside temperature, average temperature, not 29 but let us say 32, then you have to make an adjustment to the values obtained from the table. That adjustment is given by this equation, the adjusted CLTD values is equal to tabular values plus 25 minus TI plus T average minus 29. So, as I said, let us say that your TI value is 25, then this will not, this adjustment will not be there. But if the average temperature is higher than 29, then you have to add that to the value that you obtain from the table. Okay, so that is how you get the adjusted CLTD values. Okay. And solar, this data is also applicable to solar radiation typical of July 21st at 40 degree north latitude. But in the absence of more accurate data, the tables can be used without significant error for 0 degrees to 50 degrees north latitude for summer months. Okay. And data is also available for other types of walls and roofs and for different latitudes. And adjustments are also suggested for walls and roofs with insulation, wetted roofs, etc. Okay. So, if you look at the ASHRAE handbooks or other air conditioning handbooks, all these tables are given, either CLTD tables. If you look at other handbooks, they give what is known as effective temperature difference tables, okay, as a function of the type of the wall, orientation, solar time and all that for a fixed conditions. And they also suggest adjustments for other conditions. Okay. So, if you have the tables and your specific conditions, then you can get the tabular value, apply the adjustment and get the adjusted value of CLTD or ETD. Okay. That one must use for calculating the heat transfer rate. Okay. And thus from the knowledge of CLTD or ETD, overall heat transfer coefficient and area of the wall or roof, one can easily calculate the heat transfer rate of the condition space as Q in is equal to UA into CLTD or UA into ETD. So, CLTD value get from the table, U value calculate from the specification of the wall and A is the surface area of the wall. Okay. Now, the empirical methods based on CLTD or ETD are widely used by air conditioning engineers. However, since these methods are subjected to severe several limitations, a safety factor is always assumed to account for these. Okay, so, they are not 100% accurate, all these empirical methods. So, to take care of this, a safety factor is always assumed. More accurate estimates can be made by using numerical methods, which however are time consuming and expensive. Okay, if your building is having a different shape or if you want more accurate results, you have to apply the numerical methods. So, numerical methods, the advantage is that you can take care of any shape or any boundary condition, but the problem is that they are expensive and they are also time consuming. So, that is the reason why most of the time the air conditioning engineers use the empirical methods and provide a safety factor to take care of the inaccuracies. Okay. So, at this point I end this lecture, and in the next lecture I shall discuss the actual estimation of cooling loads on the buildings. Thank you.